our article is named Molecular Characterization of WDR13 Knockout Female Mice Uterine, a model for human endometrial hyperplasia. There are the authors and its presence by Manuel Aguilar Moreno and me, Lorena Alzate Ciro. We are in third semester at Universidad Pontificia Bolivariana.
Hello, we're gonna start talking about the main topic, that is the endometrial hyperplasia. The endometrial hyperplasia is a condition where the endometrial glands show a proliferation of the epithelial cells, as we can see here. We also have some risk factors like the obesity, the hyperinsulinemia, and the elevated levels of estrogen. Those are really important in this article. Now we have the endometrial cancer, that is the consequence of the evolution of the endometrial hyperplasia. It's one of the most common reproductive cancers, and it's about the 90% of the uterine cancers.
So WDR13 is an X-like gene that is expressed in several tissues, including uterine, protecting from the endometrial hyperplasia. In the study, the gene knockout produced endometrial hyperplasia, showing the protective function of the gene. The WDR13 is expressed in humans and mice, making sense to this study. And it's also important to mention that two kinds of rats were used, the wild type that is still having the gene and the knockout type.
The objective in the present study is to show that the WDR13 knockout female mice developed benign proliferative epithelium that progressed into EH, that is endometrial hyperplasia, at around 1 year of age. And it was accompanied by an increased body weight and elevated estradiol levels.
Now we are going to talk about the methods. First, immunohistochemistry is the identification of a tissue by means of a specific interaction between an antigen and antibody, where the antibody has been visibly marked. The cell is colored to demonstrate the present and cellular location of a molecule of interest. Immunohistochemistry was used to analyze the Ki67 cell proliferation marker and showed proliferative epithelium in glandular regions of mutant mice in comparison to those of wild-type mice. Now, Western blot is used to identify the reaction between an antigen and antibody, since both are proteins. Electrophoresis is done first, and then the specific proteins are identified. It was used to see the interaction of the gene with other proteins.
Now, the PCR. The PCR is a technique used to get a big amount of copies from one fragment of DNA of interest. In this case, it was used to show the inhibition of the cyclin G2 and P21 in the cell cycle. So as the WDR13 gene is knocked out in this case, these cyclins are not doing its job, so that's the reason of the endometrial hyperplasia, because there's no inhibition of the cell cycle. Now we have the ELISA. The ELISA is a technique, a serological technique, where we use an antigen or antibody to identify another antigen or antibody absorbed by a solid phase or a surface. And to reveal the antigen or antibody relationship, an anticonjugate is used. In this case, the ELISA was used to measure the plasma levels of estradiol, insulin, and progesterone.
En esta figura 1A podemos evidenciar en la parte inferior la beta-actina, una proteína presente en todas las células, por lo cual se usa como control de esta prueba. Por otro lado, si vemos el más-más, nos referimos a las ratas de tipo salvaje, que tienen el gen WDR13, el cual cumple un papel protector en la hiperplasia endometrial. Pero cuando vemos el menos menos, nos referimos a las ratas knockout, que tienen el gen silenciado, lo cual hará que a largo plazo desarrollen la condición. Es importante tener en cuenta que el gen WDR13 tiene dos isoformas, la de 53 kilodaltons y la de 40 kilodaltons, siendo más específica esta última, cuya expresión desaparece por completo, acá evidenciado en la falta de la banda. En esta figura B se puede evidenciar que en el ratón de tipo knockout, es decir, menos menos, hay una proliferación de células en el epitelio glandular, fenómeno propio de la hiperplasia endometral. Y en el ratón de tipo salvaje, es decir, más más, se puede ver un útero con miometrio y glándulas en apariencia normal.
En la figura 3 vemos que tanto se expresan cuatro proteínas. Está los receptores de estrógenos alfa, los receptores de estrógeno beta, el PI3K, que es muy importante en algunas vías de crecimiento celular, y el PAX2, que es, juega un papel fundamental en el desarrollo embrionario del tracto geniturinario y posteriormente va a evitar la muerte celular. Y también se ve la actina, que sabemos que es una proteína de control. Entonces, se encontraron resultados inversamente proporcionales entre los dos tipos de rata. Está la WDR13++, que es el tipo salvaje que aún tiene el gen, y el WDR13-, que es el tipo knockout que tiene el gen silenciado. Entonces, en el WDR13++ se encontraron disminuidos los niveles de PI3K y receptor de estrógeno tipo alfa, mientras que se encontraron aumentados los receptores de estrógeno beta y el PAX2. En el knockout se encontraron aumentados los niveles de receptor de estrógeno tipo alfa del PI3K y disminuidos los de PAX2 y receptor de estrógenos beta. Entonces, cabe recordar que en la hiperplasia endometrial los niveles de estrógeno altos son característicos en el ratón knockout. Es por esto que a mayor cantidad de estrógenos, mayor cantidad de receptores, y por eso se ve tan aumentada la expresión de este gen que codifica para esa proteína. En esta otra gráfica, en la figura 5, vamos a ver tres cosas principales. Entonces está los receptores de estrógeno alfa, el gen, el DAPI, que va a teñir las zonas externas de la célula, y el MERGE, que va a ser la sobreposición de los tres cuadros anteriores. Entonces, como aquí sabemos que un gen va a codificar para una proteína, entonces se va a estar teñiendo eso. Y la tinción va a ser directamente proporcional a qué tanto se expresa ese gen. Entonces, como vemos, el gen WDR13 tiene una tinción muy tenue. Y acá en el MERGE se ve como si desapareciera por completo. Eso quiere decir que es el ratón knockout porque está inhibida la expresión de esa proteína. Mientras que los receptores de estrógeno tipo alfa se ven muy teñidos debido a que, como expliqué en la gráfica anterior, a mayor niveles de estrógeno, mayores receptores.
Now, discussion. These authors propose that endometrial hyperplasia condition characterized by the presence of proliferative epithelial glandular cells is one of the main risk factors for endometrial cancer, and they are agreed with the rest of the article. Felix proposed that anomaly in the expression of cell cycle regulators is often associated with hyperplasia condition, and they are agreed. And the last one, Fiorito, Katika, and Hurtado proposed that estradiol is known to mediate regulation of its target genes by direct interaction with ER-alpha, and they are agreed with the rest of the article.
Now the conclusions. So the first one is that the inhibition of the WDR13 gene will cause endometrial hyperplasia of the epithelial glandular cells and to long-term endometrial cancer. The second one is that the obesity, the hyperinsulinemia, and the high levels of estradiol that are the risk factors have been shown to have an important implication in the development of the endometrial hyperplasia, interfering with factors like the FADPAD, the receptors, among others. And the last one is that the expression of proteins like ER-alpha, ER-beta, PIX2, and PI3K that are involved in the human endometrial hyperplasia were also found in the mutant mice, indicating similarity of the WDR13-, that is the knockout mice, with the human condition.